See me and hear me now. My name is Jon Blackburn, and I'll be chairing this webinar today. So first of all, I'd just like to welcome you to the webinar. This webinar is titled Offshore Wind Engineering from Sea to Sky. It's a joint webinar brought to you by TWI and our professional division, the Welding Institute, in particular, Technical Group for Offshore Energy of the Welding Institute. So from a schedule perspective, we start today in about 2 minutes' time. Myself and Chris Punshon will be giving an overview of TWI and a view of the industry picture for offshore wind. And then we have Andrew Macdonald from Offshore Renewable Energy Catapult and a range of TWI speakers. So we aim to finish at about 12:15 today. We have a second session tomorrow that runs on the same time slots, so from 9:10 till 12:15. There will be a comfort break for people between 10:30 and 10:45, where you can refresh and get some hot drinks if you need them. If time allows, after each presentation, we will ask questions, and you can put questions in the Q&A box. If time doesn't allow, we have a slot from 11:45 until 12:15, where we can pick up any questions that we don't have time to do after the presentations. So just before I give a quick introduction to TWI, there's a couple of housekeeping things to go through here that I've been provided by our IT department. One about speakers and headphones. And then if you're wondering how to ask questions during the webinar, there's a Q&A function down here on the bottom. If you click that, you'll be able to ask questions to the panelists. And just so everyone is aware, we are recording this webinar, and we will make this available to all attendees early next week. Okay, so I will start just by giving a quick overview of TWI. We've got a wide range of people registered for this webinar. So some of you may be familiar with TWI, some of you perhaps not already. But just to give a brief overview, TWI is an independent research and technology organization. There is a sister division, which is the professional division called the Welding Institute, similar to the Institute of Mechanical Engineers, etc. The origins of TWI date back to 1923, and as an independent research and technology organization, we will actually celebrate our 75th anniversary next year. So we are one of the world's leading experts in engineering, materials, welding and joining. And typically we provide advice and know-how in design, fabrication, failure analysis and failure prevention to our industrial membership base. So we have approximately 700 industrial members based in nearly 5,000 locations worldwide. And critically as a business, we are non-profit distributing. So any surplus that we generate, we reinvest back into the business for the benefit of our industrial members. And we exist for the benefit of our industrial members. We have 5 UK locations. So our headquarters is in Cambridge. And then we have 4 regional centres in different areas of the UK. In Scotland, we have a training centre in Aberdeen. And then we have 3 technology centres in different parts of England. So in the northeast, in Middlesbrough, we have a centre that looks at non-metallics, arc welding and inspection. And there is a diving inspection tank there as well for training purposes. In Rotherham, on the Advanced Manufacturing Park there, we have a centre that looks at additive manufacturing and friction stir welding. And then in South Wales, in Port Talbot, we have an NDT centre. And then overseas, we have a range of offices. Typically, these offices are training offices with a small amount of engineering services provided, typically from our Southeast Asia office in Kuala Lumpur and several offices in the Middle East. The majority of our employees are based in the UK, and that is typically where most of our research and technology is performed. So on an average year, TWI does about 1,800 projects. The vast majority of these projects are confidential to the client. They're what we call single client projects. But we do undertake core research, which is available to all of our members and funded from the membership fees that are paid. And we do participate in leverage projects funded by the UK or the European government. We have about 900 staff worldwide and about 6,000 years of combined TWI experience. The majority of our activity is from UK customers, but we have growing activity in the Americas, Middle East and Africa, Asia and Europe. From a research and technology perspective, we have core capabilities in the following areas. In advanced manufacturing, where we undertake our joining, our welding, our additive manufacturing, and some of our surface engineering activities. We have expertise in materials and structural integrity around materials and how they perform in different environments, why they fail. We have expertise in fatigue and fracture testing and understanding how parts and assets perform through their whole life integrity and how we manage the integrity of these assets from commissioning to decommissioning. And we have technical expertise in non-destructive testing, but both conventional non-destructive testing like radiography as well as more advanced non-destructive testing such as long-range ultrasonics and condition monitoring. And then we have a growing expertise in non-metallic materials. So anything from ceramics, polymers, elastomers, as well as adhesives and sealants and polymeric based coatings. The vast majority of our project work is aimed at high integrity structures. So it's all about how do we make and design these high integrity structures using our expertise in welding and joining. How do we use them? So inspection, and then how do we perhaps reuse them and recycle them? So including decommissioning, but also possibly life extension. And all of this is underpinned through our knowledge in structural integrity assessments and our knowledge in materials, how we characterize them and how we understand they will perform. Typically, we quite like to get involved in projects from a concept development stage. This allows us to put our expertise in where it de-risks new concepts and then follow the concept development all the way through feasibility to perhaps procedure development, to the specification and procurement of assets and materials, and then through commissioning and on-site support. But sometimes we get involved at the other end where things have failed and there are there's detailed expertise and understanding needed so that assets that have been produced in a similar way and with similar materials, we can understand if the failure mechanisms will affect them. But we can get involved at any point through the project lifecycle. So I've mentioned before the type of services that we provide in terms of projects. So we are membership based, so our membership comes with free services once you've paid the membership fee. And this includes access to our website and all the information that is on our website, free technical inquiries through our duty engineers, access to our CRP, which is worth about £3.5 million per year, and all the historic reports that come with that. Some prepaid consultancy, so 20% of the membership fee is available to spend immediately on R&D. And then other services as well. Outside of membership, if you want to do project work, you can undertake that by doing it by proposal. So this could be for R&D testing, it could be joining a joint industry project, it could be undertaking projects on behalf of third parties, such as your supply chain, expert witness or litigation work. and getting discounts on training TWI software products, for example. And here's a selection of some of our members. So our members include some very large blue chip companies that will be recognized by all households around the world. But they also include very small companies as well. So we have companies that go right through the supply chain, which is important because the solution to industry problems isn't just at the top level of industry. Our knowledge needs to be imparted through these companies' supply chains to achieve an effective result. Okay, so that's all I wanted to say about TWI. And now I'll hand over to my colleague, Chris Punshon, who's presenting twice in this webinar series. This first presentation, he is going to present and give a bit of an overview of the offshore wind sector. Chris, can you share your slides?
Yep.
So just while Chris shares his slides, I'll just introduce him. So Chris joined TWI in 1983, working as a project leader after graduating from Sheffield University with a degree in metallurgy. While he's been working at TWI, he's done a number of research programs, mostly related to the power, oil and gas, and marine and power sectors. He's been responsible for developing advanced joining processes for pipelines and pressure plants, in particular from an electron beam welding perspective. And his current role is leading TWI's business strategy with regard to our work in nuclear fusion, fission, and renewable energy, including offshore wind, solar PV, hydro, and geothermal. Over to you, Chris.
Okay, thanks, John. I hope you can see my slide. I'd just like to thank John for the introduction and to start the presentation by looking at the perspective of offshore wind historically. And this, the scope of the talk this morning is going to look at this historical perspective and just a few of the technology and financial drivers affecting offshore wind and the recent developments in things like power to X, so changing offshore wind energy into other types of energy. And to finalise the talk, I'll just talk about a little amount of TWI's activities and support to the offshore wind industry. And this first two pictures really sum up the situation that in the 1970s and 80s, there was a lot of onshore wind turbines built. There's now 4,930 at Alter Mount, and they start off with 100 kilowatt machines. And today we're talking about 13 megawatt offshore wind turbines. There's been a massive steep learning curve in the offshore wind industry. So again, looking historically, if you go back, the first electricity produced from wind energy was in 1885. So a university in Askov, Denmark, began producing electricity from a windmill, effectively. And the first offshore turbine was commissioned in 1990. And the first offshore wind farm at Vindeby in Denmark was in 1991. So there's been a very rapid increase in the exploitation of offshore wind energy. And looking now at the first greater than one gigawatt offshore wind farm in Hornsea 1 is about to come on stream. And interestingly, the first concept of offshore wind was described in the 1970s, and this is an artist's impression of what it might look like. And actually, it doesn't look that different in reality. If we're looking at floating structures, the first floater was a tension leg platform produced in 2007. This was for an experimental program. But more recently, High Wind have tested a 2.3 megawatt floating offshore wind turbine in Norway. And the first floating offshore wind farm is the High Wind Scotland development, which was installed in 2017. But also, again, looking at the news, we've got High Wind Tampen in Norway producing an 88 megawatt offshore wind floating farm. So the drivers and the trends in offshore wind are really that there's a huge global take up, and the driver is decarbonizing energy production. And throughout the offshore wind and onshore wind program, there's been a driver to eliminate subsidies from governments, but also to maintain a security of supply. So the intermittency of offshore wind is something that is still a concern. So storage solutions are becoming more commonplace. And a big difference is how projects are financed. And that's something perhaps Andrew Macdonald will talk about later on. But the trend really is towards bigger turbines, longer blades. This is a 107 meter long blade produced by LM Wind Power in the photograph. There's a big offshore wind monopile foundation shown in the photograph below. So the trend is towards bigger structures, bigger blades, deeper water to go further offshore. And this in turn introduces a lot of challenges in manufacturing and installation methods. Those in themselves have environmental impacts. There's concerns about the cetacean population and bird strikes. And in fact, TBI are involved in a project looking at the effect of offshore wind on radar and how to mitigate the deleterious effect of large rotating blades on radar for aircraft traffic control. The trend though now is to standardize designs and to get into serial manufacture. So this has been very effective in reducing costs, particularly for foundations and the metal structures, but also in terms of the economics of offshore wind, that operations and maintenance are key to keeping the costs at a reasonable level. The challenge is to connect all these offshore wind and onshore wind structures to the grid. And there's a lot of joint ventures and collaborative projects becoming more popular. And finally, the idea of storing offshore wind energy in an effective way is becoming clear. And the idea of power to X, so to offshore wind renewable energy being used to generate some other form of energy as a way of storage. So you can see the trend in offshore wind turbine size is from 1991 to the current day. I think there's a misprint in Hornsea 2, that should be 2020. And there's over three decades has been a massive increase in the size of the rotors. And because it's an R squared relationship, you can see there's a huge amount of power being generated by a single turbine today. And in terms of investment, the effect of COVID has not had a negative impact on the investment. And you can see in 2020, there's about £24 billion being invested in the first half of 2020, despite the economic shock due to COVID. Globally, this is a huge market trend as well. So places like Japan, Taiwan, Vietnam, and in particular, China has got some large wind investment plans. And across the world, the United States as well is becoming a big player in the offshore wind industry. And in terms of power to X, this is a concept of using the offshore wind power generated to electrolyze water, to produce hydrogen, to power existing oil and gas production platforms, and also to use the wells to pump carbon for carbon sequestration in wells. So there's a whole industry starting to emerge from renewable energy being used to generate other forms of energy. So in terms of where TWI acts, there's a very long list here which I won't go through, but basically we're involved in all stages of offshore wind manufacture and use, from foundation fabrication to blade inspection for coatings for blades, anti-ice coatings, looking at mooring lines for offshore structures, in fact, mooring chains. You see in the image here, we have an offshore mooring chain test facility. We also have an NDT speciality for inspection of subsea chains. So there's the whole range of things that TWI get involved in throughout this spectrum of application. And if anybody wants to know more about it, please get in touch with us. So finally, just a few images of things we have been involved in. So adhesive bonding for blade structures, We've been looking at rapid manufacturing processes for offshore wind foundations, corrosion mitigation techniques, anti-ice and anti-wear coatings for offshore wind turbine blades, and on-site inspection. So as John mentioned, we also do real inspection on site, but also we do failure analyses if there is a fault to be found. So I'll stop there. So if there are any questions, either please put them in the Q&A or we can talk about them later at the end. So thank you very much, and I'll pass you over to back to John for the next presentation.
Great, thank you, Chris. That was a great introduction to the day. I can see a couple of people are raising their hand. Just a reminder that for Q&A, there's a Q&A button on the bottom. If you click on that, you'll be able to type in your question. We've got time for, I think, just one quick question. So the first question that we've got is, most blades are produced in composite materials. Could it be possible to make these blades in other lightweight materials like aluminium? If not, what are the drawbacks? I don't know if you have a comment on that one, Chris.
I think there's a lot of interest currently being looked at blade materials, and because blades are getting bigger, there's also a recycling aspect, because composite materials are not ideally placed for recycling. So there is a certain amount of research going on currently to look at alternative materials to glass reinforced epoxy, and I'd imagine that maybe there are some blade manufacturers on the line, but the current industry standard is balsa wood and GRP, but there are, I know, certain developments going on in that area, and certainly looking at more recyclable composite materials is one of the favourites there. I'll try and get some more information. If you want to send me a note, I'll try and get some more information and get back to you.
Great, thank you, Chris. Okay, so we'll move on to our next presentation of the day then. So our next presentation is from Andrew Macdonald from the Offshore Renewable Energy Catapult. Andrew, if you'd just like to upload your slides while I give you a quick introduction. So Andrew is the program director at the Offshore Renewable Catapult. He's director of the Offshore Wind Growth Partnership and senior innovation manager. These roles provide a combination of innovation support for high growth SMEs with business transformation support for the wider offshore wind supply chain. Andy has worked in the renewable sector for the last 10 years, helping to develop companies in the offshore wind and tidal energy sectors. So over to you, Andrew.
Hey, thank you, John. And thanks for the introduction. I guess I'm an electrical engineer by background, but I end up sitting somewhere between business and technology. And that's what I really enjoy. And this is a fantastic sector. So happy to share some thoughts and happy to take some questions at the end and see what we're doing. So as John says, I work for the Offshore Renewable Energy Catapult and also for the Growth Partnership. So the distinction being the Growth Partnership is about supply chain growth. The Catapult is much more about the technology and innovation side of things. So I thought I'd start off with a picture that I can kind of sums up the theme, the sea to sky a theme that we're talking about today. This is our leave-and-mouth turbine. It's a 7-megawatt Samsung a turbine. I think the other interesting thing in this picture, so this isn't a huge turbine by today's standard. It's, 196 meters to the tip, 75 meter blades. So it's a big turbine, but it's not the biggest anymore. Interesting to see the oil rigs in the background. I grew up in Aberdeen, and it was always, you could always tell the oil price by the number of the oil rigs that were sitting off the coast. I think since this photo was taken, there's probably been a few more, and there's, you know, very much following wind in the sector at the moment in terms of the growth. So I thought this picture would kind of just sum up where we are and give you an idea of the scale of the technology that we're looking at. What I want to cover today is I'll tell you a wee bit about the Catapult, and I think our services are very complementary to what TWI is doing, and I think you'll see that, and I think there's lots of opportunities to work together going forward. I'll talk a bit about market forecasts and dig in a bit more into the areas of growth that we expect to see, a bit on technology trends and a bit on what Catapult's doing in terms of applied research, and then happy to take questions at any of the breaks or sessions or follow up with me. So just in terms of Catapult, the Catapult is one of the network of Catapults across the UK, part supported by the UK government. We have our headquarters in Glasgow, but we also have a large test facility in Blyth. And then we have some smaller offices across the country and some close collaborations with four universities, three research hubs, looking specifically at powertrains, blades, and electrical infrastructure. So we're here to help the sector. We're here to create economic growth for the sector through the engineers and the facilities that we have. Just a few more pictures just to kind of highlight what we do. As I say, we're predominantly engineering based. You know, the 200 staff, the vast majority are engineers. That's what we do best. That's what we enjoy. A couple of pictures here just to kind of give you an idea of some of the things that we do. The bottom is the blade from the Halyard X that Chris was talking about. So this is a 107 meter blade, which we'd fit into a 100 meter blade test facility, which shows the rate of growth. When we planned the blade test facility 4 or 5 years ago, a 100 meter seemed more than enough for any blade anyone was going to test. But yet, a few years later, we're offloading a 107 meter blade to test in that facility. on the right, we've got the Fujian test facility, which is a 15 megawatt drivetrain test facility. Again, we thought it would be oversized, but it will be reaching its limits over the next few years, I'm sure. And the image at the top is really just showing the emphasis we've got at the moment on operational maintenance and robotics. So how we can actually put robotic inspection. And I think there's a lot of overlap with the NDT and some of the work that TWI is doing. So that's an overview of what we're doing. This is the wider picture of the facility. So as well as the blade test and the drivetrain facilities, we've also got docks. So we can do a real full-scale testing in underwater conditions, and we can look at seabed conditions. And there's a number of projects that I think we're talking about in terms of thermally sprayed aluminium that we're involved in being tested at the facility here. So very flexible, and you know, some great opportunities for projects to take place here. A bit more details. The work that we do tends to focus around the test facilities that we have. So we do a lot of work on blades. Again, this is a slightly smaller blade. This is an 84 meter ALM blade that was tested last year. But it gives you an idea of the scale. There's the kind of standard sized human being on the left-hand side to give you an idea of the scale. But this is, as I say, yeah, that's a smaller blade than we're currently testing at the moment. We also have a smaller blade test rig, and we're looking at a innovative ways of testing, doing dual axis testing as opposed to single axis testing. So testing in flatwise and edgewise directions at the same time. And then the material side is obviously an important part of that. Just as an aside, a quick plug for ACT Blade, who do textile covered blades. So when I asked the question earlier, if you're interested in alternate ways of making blades, they're using composite spars with ribs and then textile stretched over them. So really, really interesting about how you can lightweight blades using other materials. So happy to talk to anyone about that today afterwards if you're interested. The powertrain test facility, we've got the 50 megawatt test facility, but also we can test at 1 megawatt and 3 megawatt as well. So interested in that side, but also on the bearing side. And again, I'm sure there's crossovers with what a liability. And then just the other facilities we have on the electrical side, we test cables, and we've seen one of the technology trends moving to larger, higher voltages, both for array and export cables. We're involved in testing of the 66 kV array cables. So we have high voltage labs that are capable of doing the deep testings on those cables. And then the O&M side, which is growing and growing, huge amounts of overlap with the oil and gas sector, and the subsea technology specializations coming out of oil and gas is fantastic to see how we can one, improve reliability, but also reduce cost and increase health and safety offshore. So that's kind of a bit of a run through of the catapult and what we do. I'd like to talk a bit more about the market and the growth and where we see things going. And then I'll talk about some technology trends and the research that we're doing. So by way of background, I think it's always important to kind of remind ourselves that, you know, however much we look in our crystal balls and predict what's going to happen in the sector, energy is an inherently political, economic, and social. And you know what we've seen recently is some quite extraordinary things in that, you know, we've had a Conservative Prime Minister announcing to the Conservative Party conference that the UK is going to be the Saudi Arabia wind power. Now, even 2 years ago, I don't think you'd have seen that one coming. I think the government is absolutely 100% behind offshore wind at the moment. And we're also seeing huge support from the oil and gas sector. And I could have put up a picture of any of the chief execs of the oil and gas primes here, but BP, you know, are signing up joint ventures with other leading offshore developers and, you know, really putting a lot of investment into the sector. And I think that will change the rate of growth as well as the scale of projects that will start to happen. Having said that, there's always challenges from different sides. We're going through strange times at the moment. You know, lots of positive things coming through in the spending review. But there's always that battle between the kind of push for the green agenda and climate change mitigation against the issue of actually where to spend money. And there's other technologies as well. So lots of interest at the moment in modular reactors. And there's always issues, environmental issues. And it can get spun in different ways. So this was a report RSPB produced. Broadly in favour of offshore wind, but the way it was positioned within some of the press was that there were some serious issues there, and I think it just shows that there's still some areas where there are concerns about offshore wind, and we need to take those into account, and we need to make sure that we're doing all the environmental work absolutely to prove the case for offshore wind. So, you know, very, very rosy outlook, but you know we need to keep up our guard and make sure that we are continuing to make the case for it. So, a few numbers for you. There's been a huge drop, about 60% a drop in the last 15 years, I guess, of prices for offshore wind. And what's interesting is to run it against the wholesale electricity prices. So wholesale electricity are forecast to go up, which helps make the case for it. But there's been a phenomenal cost reduction, primarily driven by larger turbines, but also by a reduced cost within the supply chain and reduced operational costs. So huge cost reduction on fixed bottom, which is the blue line. But we're also starting to see, and we're from a catapult perspective, we're forecasting that floating wind, a cost of energy will drop significantly. It's much higher at the moment, but we think as it's industrialized, it will come down and be competitive by about 2030. So there's a lot of interest in that. Just the one caveat on floating wind is this came from, it was actually on LinkedIn this morning. So I shamelessly pinched the picture, but it really just to me summed up the scale. So we can look at charts and say cost of floating wind is coming down and we need to industrialize. This is what we need to industrialize. So I think there's certainly some challenges there around how that's done. The scale of these projects are phenomenal. You know, sometimes when they're on the horizon, literally, they look relatively small, but when you're up close, these are big, big engineering projects. A few more numbers, and I apologize for the number of graphs here. I'll let you look at them at your leisure when you get them sent out. But I just wanted to show the story so far, and this is building on what Chris was saying. But the UK has been leading the pack very much in terms of offshore wind. The black areas at the bottom is the UK content. And so this is to date, and we've seen a rapid growth, 28% a compound annual growth across the piece. So very, very rapid growth, with the UK leading the way and Europe leading the way very much. The top slide is annual numbers, and the bottom slide is cumulative. So there's a couple of slides here, so just to get you into the way of thinking around that. So then if you start looking forward, this is our forecast out to 2050. And whilst the numbers do increase and are massive growth, actually the growth rate actually slows down. So whilst people kind of look at it and think we'll never achieve that, it's actually, if you think of the rate that we have grown so far, actually the rate of growth is actually slowing down. There's still some big numbers that we need to hit. So looking at a 2030 approaching annual installations of almost 25 gigawatts or 24 gigawatts by 2030, that's a lot of installations, that's a lot of turbines going in every year. But what you're also seeing out to 2050 is you're seeing other markets growing. So particularly you're seeing China growing, you're seeing that North America is growing as well. And other countries within Asia are also seeing significant growth. So whilst the UK has a leading position now, the market is global, and we're really keen to encourage companies to consider their exporting opportunities as well. The final graph, it's not the final graph, there's a couple more. The final one of this series is really just to show the split between OPEX and CAPEX. And I think it's interesting, in the bottom one, what you're starting to see is the CAPEX amounts are leveling off to an extent, but the OPEX is growing. So if you're looking at where to play within the sector over the longer term, there's a huge amount of opportunity within operations that will continue to be there in the longer term. So that's the last of those ones. I kind of wanted to drill down another layer into it and look at what parts of the turbine, what parts of offshore wind are growing as well. And I've got a couple of slides on this one. This one is really just showing that if you look at the makeup of offshore wind, the turbines are by far the largest part, and then the balance of plants. So that's looking at the substations and the electrical equipment around that. And those are the areas that take up the largest proportion of spend, and therefore that's where the opportunities are. But this is just for the UK, and looking at a 75 gigawatt by 2050, which is what the Committee for Climate Change is saying is necessary as in order to achieve net zero. So we're kind of well on the way there, but still, lots of opportunity for further growth. I wanted to break that down a little more again, so getting into where the different parts come from. And this is a slightly older slide, but I think it makes the point. So this is based on 30 gigawatt by 2030. The government target now is 40 gigawatts, so the numbers will increase again. But what this is trying to show is within those subsectors of where the growth is, how much of that is volume driven, how much of that is market share driven. And the distinction there being that the volume driven will grow organically. It's the O&M side predominantly, and it'll grow because of the volume. So in terms of interventions, in terms of how do we drive that will to an extent drive itself, because the O&M will, the UK will always be based around the UK. But the areas where we need to reduce costs and become more competitive from a UK perspective around the turbine supply, foundations, export cables are the areas where we need to grow if we're going to hit our targets of 60% of UK content in UK wind farms by 2030. So it's just kind of showing where we're looking at. So turbine supply, foundation supply, areas where we do really need to do more. So that's the last slide that I've got, kind of looking at the numbers. I wanted to look at some technology trends and what's driving cost reductions going forward. And one of the big things I talked about was around a turbine size. And I apologize, I should really have a picture of some monster turbines here. Instead, I've got what to me is actually a more interesting take on it. And this I shamelessly pinched from Henrik Steesdale, who's a legend within the sector, former chief technology officer at Siemens Gamesa. And he plotted the Siemens Gamesa turbines on a log scale over the last 20 years. And it's actually, it's remarkable how you can draw a straight line through it. And it really does show how, you know, there's this doubling over every 10 years, there's a doubling in size in terms of output capacity going forward. And if you take that forward, we're now at, the Haliad X, the GE turbine is a 30 megawatt turbine. That will grow without a doubt, along with the other manufacturers, to 15. That's kind of easy to see. If you extrapolate this further, you start to get to 2030. You'd be looking at getting up to 20 megawatt turbines, which would have a rotor size of 260 meters. Take that out to 2050, you're talking about 84 megawatt turbines, which would have a rotor size of over 500 meters. So at some point, there will be some physical limitations to growth, whether that's blade length or a capability for lift from installation vessels or manufacturing capacity, or the kind of break-even point in terms of a cost reduction on the CapEx versus OpEx and installation. So at some point it will level off, but so far there doesn't seem to be a sign of that. And as I said earlier, when talking about the blade facility, we didn't see blades over 100 meters just a few years ago. And now, we're at 107 meters. There's certainly plans for longer than that. So turbine size is been absolutely the biggest driver for cost reduction and to an extent will continue to do so. I just wanted to cover some of the kind of non-structural areas as well to kind of highlight where there are areas for opportunity and areas for research and other companies to get involved. And one of those is around project development, which is sometimes overlooked, but there's about 70 layers of data needed during the site selection and development of a wind farm. And that takes you from, the geotech, the geophys, through to all of the benthic data sets, the environmental data sets, the above water, the environmental ones. And loads of really interesting work can be done there. And if you think these turbines are getting bigger, they're actually getting into slightly different atmospheric conditions as well. Once you get up to 300 meter tip height, you're starting to get low jet streams and there's other things that will start to affect the performance in good ways and bad ways as well. So huge amounts of data collection on very, very large areas when you look at what the potential rollout to getting to 75 gigawatts are. So the opportunities for autonomous surface vessels and drones and subsea is really an opportunity that I think there's going to be some big growth and some interesting activity taking place to actually get through the amount of work needed. When we look at things like fabrication and, from a TWI side, I guess the obvious side is looking at the substructures, but there's also some really interesting work needed to be done on the composite sides as well. So this is a picture, this is a Siemens factory. And you can see it's still quite a manual process in many cases. But these, you're making a components that need to last at least 25 years in very harsh conditions. So they need to be, very highly engineered. That performance and that quality control is absolutely essential for that. So again, there's areas where I think there's opportunities to support the manufacturers, the fabricators within this area. And that applies, like I say, to towers, whether it's monopiles, towers, jackets, as well as blades. But I thought this was a good photo that kind of captured the manual intervention that's needed in order to manufacture some of these very, very large structures. The offshore aspect and installation aspect is one that sometimes is overlooked. I think that the cost of installation is still a very, very significant part of the build out. These vessels are phenomenally expensive and every hour that can be saved in terms of installation will save large amounts of money in terms of the overall project. So you know, solutions around lifting control, positioning, tracking, these kinds of things are actually incredibly important in terms of how we install turbines. And going forward, if we look to floating wind, how do we install floating wind turbines is still a question that's being asked, partly because there's no clarity on a centralized design that people are moving towards. There's still a number of different floating designs that are being considered, which would have different installation methodologies. But anything that can, any time offshore is incredibly expensive. So anything that can be done to look at reducing that is incredibly valuable. The last area I was going to look at is really on the O&M. And again, you know, you saw from the earlier slides that O&M is a significant part of the overall cost of a wind farm. And that's partly because it means taking personnel offshore and working on maintenance and repairs. As wind farms get further and further offshore, there's a move to using SOVs to service operation vessels where the technicians are offshore for a number of weeks and coming back onshore. So much more similar to an oil and gas type setup. But still, the need to reduce intervention is very, very strong. So if we can move from rope access, the picture on the left, to a robotic access and blade repair, then I think we'll be able to increase cost reductions and improve a health and safety as well, particularly as number of turbines grow. So that was kind of the final example. I just wanted to highlight some of the areas that potentially don't get as much coverage as they potentially should, but where I think there's actually significant opportunities. Just check my time, I'm not going over too much. Hey, I just finally wanted to highlight some of the areas that Catapult itself is working on. So we do a lot of work supporting smaller companies and industry in terms of delivery of projects, but we also do have our own research team. And these are just very quickly some of the areas that we're looking at. What I wanted to highlight with the red box is that there's huge connections between different parts of the research. So if you look, for example, at leading edge erosion, which is a challenge for the sector, the blade tips can be moving at 200 miles an hour, and they have high utilization. So, you know, they are very, very difficult conditions they're operating in. What we need is not just to develop leading edge protection systems, but we also need to understand how you measure the performance of them, how you measure the physics of failure of water droplet and blade interactions. But you also need to then understand the environmental conditions that it'll be operating in. So if you take it back, we're doing work measuring droplet size offshore in order to understand physics, in order to then understand the leading edge protection systems and how we test and measure the performance of a longer period of time. So there's a lot of links through the research that we do that drives those kind of applied solutions. So those on the blades side, the recycling is a really interesting one. Love to hear if people have ideas for a manufacturing of blades that are more easily recycled, or if there's ways that people have of recycling current technologies. It's an area that I think as more and more turbines go up, I think there'll be more and more interest on recycling. Second area we kind of focus a lot on is on powertrains. And again, there's a huge focus on digital twins and digitalization. And the lever-mouth turbine I showed you at the start and positioned behind me here. It's got over 800 sensors on it. So it's a huge amount of instrumentation there. And it's used for about 45 different research projects that we've got going on that. And we're using that to build digital twins. But those improvements in condition monitoring are needed in order to gather more data, in order to understand more about the turbine, in order to then improve efficiencies and develop other solutions. So that sensor development and condition monitoring is fundamental to how you can then actually build digital twins and how you can take that forward. So that's the side that we're really interested in, as well as bearings and then the larger scale condition monitoring. And the final area I was going to look at is just the systems approach. And Chris briefly touched on opportunities for hydrogen. There's a lot of discussion. Catapult's recently produced a report on solving the integration challenge, the STIC report. And that looks at the opportunities for hydrogen combined with offshore wind. And I think there's some real potential there for green hydrogen taken forward. To do that, we need to understand the overall energy system, and we need to understand the integration, both of the electricity, but also the hydrogen into the energy network. So there's a lot of moving parts that need to come together. So lots of really interesting research going on there. Finally, I'd just like to do a plug for the other hat that I wear. So I've talked very much about what Catapult is doing. I'd like to just briefly mention that I also am Programme Director of the Offshore Wind Growth Partnership. The Growth Partnership is industry funded support. We have £100 million over the next 10 years to support specifically the supply chain to help it grow, increase competitiveness and productivity. If you go to the website, owgp.org.uk, please register. There's a big button that says I'm interested at the top right there. You can click on that and register, and you'll get further information. If you're looking at immediate opportunities, there's a button that's not on this slide, but there's a button at the top that says opportunities. And we currently have a funding call open for development grants. So we're looking for companies that are looking to scale up. The grants are between 75K and 500K with a 50% match from the applicant. But they're specifically designed for company growth, so and they can be used for CapEx or OpEx, so opportunities for investment in order to grow businesses are there. So please have a look at the website. We run funding calls and we run business transformation programs at regular intervals over the year. So if you sign up, you'll be able to see what's coming up and what opportunities are available. So that's the last slide that I have. So I'd just like to thank TWI for having me. Hopefully some of the insights have been useful. If anything I've said is of interest, I'll be around for the Q&As, or get in touch and happy to pick up with you directly. So I'll hand back to John. Thank you very much.
Great, thank you, Andrew, and much appreciate you joining us this morning. We've had a flurry of questions actually through your presentation. So thank you for offering to stick around, and we'll pick those up at about 11:45. Thank you. So our next presenter is Carol Johnston. So Carol's going to present on the importance of fatigue in the design of offshore wind structures. Excellent, her slides have just come up. So let me just introduce Carol. So Carol joined TWI in 2009, following her undergraduate and PhD at the University of Cambridge. She's a principal project leader in the fatigue integrity management section and manages a range of projects, both in internal and external. So she's got particular expertise in residence fatigue testing, but provides a broad range of consultancy on the fatigue performance of joints in general. Over to you, Carol.
Hey, hi, thanks. Thanks very much for that, John. Hi, everybody. So I'm going to focus my presentation on the importance of fatigue design for offshore wind. And I think the previous presentations and introductions have shown us very clearly how offshore wind is such a growing industry that's growing very rapidly. And it'll involve a huge amount of infrastructure and fabrication. And from experience in other industries, I think we know that future problems can be avoided if we consider the degradation of these structures at the design stage. And I come at it from a material science point of view and a fatigue engineering point of view. So that's where my presentation is going to focus today. Obviously, TWI specialises in understanding materials performance, and we have a lot of experience in the understanding the structural integrity of fabricated structures. And so, I'm going to focus on aspects relevant to fatigue performance today. So just starting off with some very basic things, although I think the other presenters have covered these quite clearly. Obviously, wind speeds increase with height and with distance of the wind turbines from shore. And obviously a wind turbine itself, as I'm going to describe it, is made up of a rotor mounted on some kind of structure. And the height of that structure is chosen to access higher wind speeds in order for the turbine to generate the most amount of power. Obviously, a wind farm is made up of many individual wind turbine structures, and these are designed and tend to be designed and fabricated in the same way. And so a wind turbine structure and foundations is a mass-produced rather than one-off kind of structure. And so if there are problems at the design or at the design stage or in the fabrication of a particular structure, then that can potentially result in quite significant problems for the wind farm as a whole. So considering the kind of structural parts of wind turbines, so obviously the wind turbine towers and foundations are very large fabricated structures. The type of foundation that's chosen depends on the water depth, and the diagram here shows a few different options. So obviously in relatively shallow waters, they use monopiles, which are tubes rolled from thick plate and joined with seam welds and with girth welds. As the water depth increases, then different types of structures like jacket structures might be more suitable. And today these have been fabricated by welding, and they include many tubular nodal joints with designs transferred from the oil and gas industry. As we move on to deeper waters, and as we've heard, floating wind becomes a bit more feasible and potentially more suitable. And floating wind has huge potential for use off the UK. And these floating structures are obviously tethered to the seabed in some way, perhaps using mooring chains or mechanical tendon connectors. So now just thinking about the loads and the things which will affect the fatigue performance of these structures. So obviously, historically, the fundamental design of wind turbine structures have been controlled by ensuring that the tower and the foundation will withstand the extreme loads that the structure will experience, based on, for example, the 50-year wave heights. Cyclic loads are obviously also important, since fatigue cracks can initiate when relatively low magnitude stresses are repeatedly applied to structures. So in addition to the cyclic loads imparted on the structure by the sea, the wind and the passing frequency of the blades and potentially resonance effects might produce additional cyclic loads. And so these wind turbine structures experience a very complex loading spectrum. If a fatigue crack does form in the structure, then the consequences depend on the location of the crack and the degree of redundancy in that structure. But if left to propagate, fatigue cracking could potentially lead to complete collapse of the structure. So ideally, obviously, the structure should be designed to be resistant to the applied stresses for the whole of its design life. And this is where fatigue design using SN curves comes in. But if cracks are found during fabrication or during service, understanding the materials properties is essential so that engineering critical assessment can be carried out to determine whether the flaws can be tolerated and to show that the structure as a whole is resistant to failure when a crack is present. So once in service, if you do know about the materials behaviour and the fatigue performance, then this allows tailored inspection programmes and therefore options for mitigation and repair of the structure. So fundamentally, the resistance of the structure to the applied loads depends on the properties of the materials. And so it's important to consider the resistance of the materials to the environmental loads in order to ensure the integrity of the structure. And given the harsh cyclic nature of applied loads, an appreciation of the fatigue performance is fundamental to offshore wind structures. Okay, so now I'm just going to go into a little bit more detail about some of the fatigue critical areas in offshore wind structures. So focusing on the fatigue resistance of the materials and components used in these wind turbine structures and foundations. As I've mentioned, there are different types of designs for foundations. And monopiles are made up using girth welds in thick section tubes. You can also have bolted flange connections, which are used to join sections of the tower together or to join the transition piece to the foundation. And in jacket structures, you have these welded tubular nodal joints. So in general, fatigue cracking tends to occur at stress concentrations. And all of these components I've just described have these sorts of stress concentrations or fatigue susceptible features. So in particular, welds are very susceptible to fatigue cracking, where cracks can occur at weld toes. And they're particularly susceptible because there are extra features such as crack-like flaws at the weld toes and high levels of residual stresses. But the components can also end up cracking due to fatigue. So if you have any changes in cross-section, which occur perpendicular to the applied loads, or notches in threads in bolts or bolted connections. So as I mentioned earlier, the fatigue performance of nominally sound structures is described using SN curves. And these allow the fatigue life at a particular stress range for a particular material or weld geometry to be calculated. And the SN curves in fatigue design codes like BS7608 and the DMV GL document C203 for welded joints were originally proposed based on tests and calculations carried out at TWI. So they were developed when large sets of data for different welded geometries were analysed to produce mean SN curves. And obviously the mean SN curves result in a 50% chance of failure. Design curves are used for design, and these are located two standard deviations below the mean, and they correspond to a 97.7% probability of survival for a particular stress range. So with an SN curve, they enable you to calculate the maximum allowable stress range, which can be applied to a particular detail to ensure that it will survive for the required design life, which is typically 20 years. Or if you have a known set of loading conditions, then SN curves allow the expected fatigue life for a particular detail to be calculated. The SN curves provided within fatigue design standards cover many different relevant components and a variety of different welded geometries, like those shown on the picture on the slide, as well as threaded fasteners and some parent materials. So documents like BS7608 that I just mentioned, which is the British Fatigue Design Guidance document, are updated when results from peer-reviewed research are presented to the standards committees for consideration. At the moment, the BS7608 committee, which is chaired by TWI, is working on a revision of 7608. But having said that, there sometimes is a lag between new designs being implemented and or old designs being used in new ways and the design guidance being updated. So there are sometimes areas where the recommendations and fatigue design standards either don't currently cover the new designs, or the existing design recommendations might be too conservative for a new application because there may be insufficient information available to the standards committee to allow the guidance to be updated and incorporated. So it's quite common for companies to perform tests on representative components in order to determine the fatigue life of their particular component and compare it to these existing standard SN curves. And this can help to assist with the design of new structures. So obviously there's a benefit of testing actual representative components rather than carrying out only finite element modelling. Because if you test actual components, then those specimens will inherently capture all aspects associated with fabricated structures. Some of these things might not necessarily be completely accounted for in finite element models. And then once you've carried out the tests, the fatigue data from those tests can provide certainty of the fatigue performance of these new structures, which can allow requirements for things like the amount of post-test fabrication inspection that's required to be relaxed potentially. So TWI has lots of different types of test facilities which are used to determine the fatigue performance of components and structures. And we're also performing research projects in different areas related to the offshore wind industry. So I'll go through some of those. So starting off with relatively standard testing, we commonly test mid-sized specimens using servo hydraulic test machines. And when I say mid-sized, these specimens are typically 500 millimetres to a metre in length. The test machines can be used to apply loads and to carry out tests on many different types of components, including welds, welded attachments. We can also test other things like composites, so segments of wind turbine blades, for example, or other types of components and fixtures. The machine shown here in this slide has a capacity of 1,000 kilonewtons, and we can use these machines to test specimens at constant or variable amplitude. So machines like this can be used to gain a better understanding of the performance of welds relevant to the wind industry. So for example, one of the aspects relevant to offshore wind and these very large structures is that the fatigue design guidance currently uses a thickness correction if you have a weld in a plate thickness greater than 25 millimetres. And this means that there's a large reduction in the calculated fatigue design life for welds in thicker plate. So for example, a weld in a 100 millimetre thick plate would be calculated to have a fatigue design life which was a factor of 2.8 lower than it would be in 25 millimetre plate. And obviously, if we're talking about long design lives, that's potentially quite a big change in the expected longevity of a structure. That thickness correction was derived by analysing a relatively thin plate than is used in the offshore wind industry. And so it may be that that's too conservative. At the moment, we're not really sure. So a specific test programme could allow longer calculated fatigue lives to be justified potentially. A similar issue applies to bolts. Again, within the offshore wind industry, very large bolts are being used. And the design standards use a reference diameter of 25 millimetres with a thickness correction to apply the SN curves to these larger diameter bolts. So we are running a research project in this area at the moment, and as part of TWI's core research programme, we're carrying out a series of tests to investigate whether this thickness correction is appropriate for these large bolts. The tests are being carried out using a high level of mean stress, equal to 70% of the specified minimum yield stress of high strength grade 10.9 M72 bolts. Which requires quite high loads and high stress levels. So they're being done on our largest servo hydraulic test machine, which has a capacity of 2,500 kilonewtons. So considering other types of structures used in offshore wind, so TWI carried out a significant programme of fatigue testing on tubular joints, and that was used to generate the data, which is the basis for the tubular joint SN curve. Which is in BSM 608, as well as other documents like ISO 19902 and C203. So those test programmes were performed on tubular joints using servo hydraulic test machines with special fixtures, like the one shown here. Strain gauges measure the applied stresses, and the strain gauges were located at specific distances from the weld toes to allow the hotspot stress at the welds to be calculated. And these days we can now also perform finite element analysis to assist with test setup and stress analysis. So with new fabrication methods being used for tubular joints in the offshore wind industry, test programs are needed to help determine whether the fatigue performance of welds made using new procedures, such as the mass-produced single-sided welds in tubular joints, can be safely predicted by the existing design curves. And similarly, with the move towards floating structures, it's been mentioned a few times already today, the offshore wind industry needs confidence in the fatigue performance of tethering systems. As Chris mentioned earlier, as part of a joint industry project, TWI developed this fatigue test machine, which was used to test large high-strength mooring chain at full scale and seawater. So that joint industry project produced test data for grade R5 mooring chain. And we also carried out related finite element modelling and inspection activities to give us a very good understanding of the fatigue performance of these large high strength mooring chains. So obviously we now have this capability to test these very large structures in seawater under fatigue loading. Another option for tethering floating structures is using tendon connectors, mechanical connectors. So these could potentially be used to replace welds within foundation structures or to tether these floating structures, as I say. So mechanical connectors can have complex geometries, which can include different changes in cross-section and other features which might be fatigue critical. And TWI has a resonance fatigue testing laboratory, and this is used to generate SN data from full-scale mechanical connectors and from welds in pipes. And we can test things with diameters up to 900 millimetres. By running these tests to failure, we can use this method to identify the fatigue critical locations within mechanical connectors. The other benefit of resonance fatigue testing is that the tests run at quite high frequencies, about 30 hertz. And so it's feasible to run tests to very high endurances. And we can also run these tests using variable amplitude loading. So TWI has proposed a joint industry project with DNV, which aims to use variable amplitude resonance fatigue testing to investigate the fatigue performance at welds in the high endurance regime of the SN curve. And obviously this is an area relevant to lots of offshore design, including offshore wind structures. So do contact me if you'd like to hear a bit more about that afterwards. So I've talked a little bit about the relatively large scale testing that TWI can carry out. In order to generate SN data to be used for fatigue design, but the other aspect of understanding fatigue performance relies on knowing the rate of fatigue crack growth, as this can be used to calculate the remaining fatigue life of a structure if it contains flaws. So TWI can carry out tests to measure fatigue crack growth rate on project specific materials and welds, and that would complement the information provided in documents such as BS 7910, which is the British guidance document for carrying out engineering critical assessments. So as well as generating actual test data, we can also gain useful insights by doing detailed examination of fracture faces and from metallographic cross sections in order to analyse the materials and welds at a microstructural level. So as well as the large scale testing, we can carry out very detailed work as well. Okay. And finally, once the fatigue performance of the structure is known through all of the testing that I've described in this presentation, there may be uncertainties of a structure when in service, due uncertainties in the actual loads experienced by a structure in service. So it can be useful to monitor the applied stresses. Andrew mentioned condition monitoring of their demonstration turbine that they have at the Catapult Centre. So this is obviously done by instrumenting the structure with strain gauges, for example, or you could use a weld-specific device like the crack burst sensor, which TWI developed to show how much of the class F fatigue life of a weld has been consumed. So that brings me to the end of my presentation. So just to sum up, incorporating fatigue considerations at the design stage to include specific information on the expected fatigue performance of these fatigue critical details can potentially help to avoid in-service failures. Since there are new structures being designed and fabricated in the offshore wind industry, and there can be a lag between the implementation of new designs and the guidance in design standards being updated, specific test programs can help to generate data and to provide designers with a good understanding of fatigue performance of their structures. So TWI can obviously help carry out test programs and carry out detailed analysis in order to help you understand the fatigue performance of your structures. So I think that brings me to the end. So I can take a couple of questions now, or we can do that in the session later on.
Thank you, Carol. We have time for a few questions, actually. So the questions are stacking up. Perhaps we'll go with the ones that are quite relevant to your presentation, if that's okay. This one here, it says, on the substructure, let's say it's a jacket type substructure, typically which one is more dominant? Fatigue damage due to wave loads or wind loads?
That's a good question. So I think the point with offshore wind structures is that all of these things are linked. So obviously the cyclic load due to both the waves and the sea combined to produce this very complex loading system on the turbine itself. And so I think it all needs to be considered together.
Okay. And then a follow-up question from the same participant, but based on past experience for fatigue damage on the jacket, do you expect to find more fatigue damage on the weld root or the weld toe?
Yeah, so within a jacket structure, obviously it's these tubular nodal joints which are of interest and are relevant to fatigue performance. So from the tests carried out previously and used to generate the tubular joint SN curves, fatigue cracks tended to occur on the cap of those welds rather than the root due to the stress gradient through those welded joints. So they tended to occur at the cap.
Thank you, Carol. Then a couple more questions. I think you probably covered this in one of your later slides. Do you have any fatigue monitoring systems for online assessment of real loads, stresses, fatigue on the wind turbine? We think this can be the best basis for potential LTO, long-term operation.
So TWI gets involved with applying strain gauges and things to actual components in order to measure applied loads. We can also assist with analysing that data and using that to understand the fatigue performance of structures. So yes, we can get involved with instrumenting actual structures and logging that data.
Thank you, Carol. When it comes to structural integrity management of supporting structures, either fixed or floating, what differences and similarities do you see compared to the common integrity assessment services in the oil and gas industry?
So there are differences between the two industries. In the oil and gas industry, obviously there tends to be a single very large structure installed in one particular location, compared to obviously having multiple wind turbine structures installed offshore. So there's very different levels of investment and cost and fabrication methods used for those two types of structures. I do think the serial kind of mass produced aspect of wind turbine structures means that different welding techniques and processes, for example, are being used, and they will potentially have different fatigue performance to those used in oil and gas structures. And obviously the fatigue design guidance, which exists at the moment, and a lot of the structural integrity assessment methods that exist in the guidance at the moment were developed based on these oil and gas structures and the approaches used in oil and gas. So there are potentially some modifications which might be needed to ensure that they apply properly and suitably to wind structures.
Carol, What does the 97.7% probability of survival represent? Is it the probability of a crack developing, or is it the probability of fracture occurring?
So that relates to the design curves the design SN curves in fatigue design standards. So if you had a number of different welds, a number of a particular geometry of weld, all subject to the same stress range, then there's a 97.7% probability that a particular weld will survive. So within that data set of welds, 97.7 out of 100 should survive without fatigue cracking, and 2.3% would end up cracking due to fatigue. So it's talking about the statistical analysis of a population of welds, for example, which is subjected to stress levels.
Great, thank you, Carol. I think we probably put you on the spot enough as we approach.
That serves me right for making my presentation too short.
No, well done, Carol. There are a number of other questions that we have yet to answer. We need to get the right panelists to answer these. So we have a session at 11:45 till 12:15 where we can pick up on these questions. So if we've not yet answered your question, don't worry, we'll do our best to answer them in that session. So let me just share my screen now. Just having a problem here. Effectively, we're going on a short 15-minute break now, so we will reconvene in 15 minutes' time. So please go and have a comfort break and grab some refreshments for the next session, where we'll be restarting with a presentation from my colleague Dave Harvey. Okay. We'll leave the webinar live. There's no need to log off and re-log on. Thank you. Presentations in this session. First, we'll start with Dave Harvey. So Dave is a technology fellow in our surfacing, corrosion, and interface engineering section. He's been at TWI since 1986, and he's played a leading role in establishing our expertise in thermally sprayed aluminium as a means to mitigate the corrosion of welded carbon steel and stainless steel structures, particularly in marine environments. He's also been instrumental in our work in the field of cold spray, supporting national and international research projects, as well as delivering training courses in this area. Over to you, Dave.
Okay, well, good morning, everybody. And John, thank you for that introduction. As John says, I'm going to talk about the use of thermal spray coatings for offshore application. I'll start by talking a little bit about surface engineering at TWI, and then explain a bit more about the subject of thermal spraying, and then talk explicitly about some of the offshore wind related projects, the Crown projects. So at TWI is an organization of around about 600 staff, and within the company, there's something like 40 people, 40 colleagues, scientists and engineers, who work on a wide variety of surface engineering and coating technologies. The one I'm going to talk about today is thermal spraying, but within TWI, we also cover many other coating processes, such as cold spraying and laser cladding, and one or two others that are in the slide. So I'm not going to go into any more detail on that, but just to mention that our competence is broader than simply thermal spraying. Within the thermal spraying area at TWI, we focus on a number of processes, both cold spray, which is a form of thermal spray, which involves solid particle deposition, and thermal spray, a number of processes which involve the spraying of molten particles on and solidification on a substrate. We're also very active in the field of surface preparation, which typically for thermal spraying and all forms of metal spraying is grit blasting. Alongside the process side, We have a number of supporting technologies. We offer characterization and testing, and we have a large scale facility, so we can do larger scale components up to several meters in size on site at Cambridge. So I'm going to move on really to talk a bit about the thermal spray process, and in particular thermal spray aluminium. This is this is a technology that's been around for several decades. First application offshore was on the Forties field, so that goes back to the 1970s. What you'll see here is that there are a couple of processes. The top left image shows you a couple of guys using a process called twin wire arc spraying. The top right slide or image shows you a picture of a guy doing wire flame spraying. So you can see there's more than one process. That's the manual side primarily in that image. It's also possible to scale up to much larger structures. And I'll come back to the bottom right image, but that is actually the twin wire arc spraying of one of the monopiles in the Arcona offshore wind farm. And we'll come back to that a bit later in the presentation. Why do we want to use thermal spraying? Well, it's a sort of alternative approach to the use of paint. I'm just going to illustrate this from a very simple test that is widely applied industrially, in fact, to assess paint or to qualify paints for marine service. This is based on ISO 12944, Part 9, Annex B, and it's basically the cyclic test that runs through 25 cycles, 25 weeks of cycles over a period with UV condensation, salt spray, and then a sort of freeze thaw cycle. So it's a pretty tough cycle. And typically what we do is we prepare the samples and you put a scribe, you put a defect into the coating, because what we want to see also is how does the coating perform when it's damaged. In the context of this work that we did, the paint is a typical offshore specification provided by International Paint, or AkzoNobel as they're now called, and the TSA is an aluminium coating of the order of 300 microns. This work was actually done as part of a JIP, which International Paint was a party to, and they did the testing. So this is what you see after about 6 months. The top left is what happens to the paint. So you'll see where the scribe has been. There's a degree of scribe creep or undercut of the paint, and you can see that we've lost several millimeters on either side of the scribe. The numbers are the adhesion. So that's the adhesion in megapascals after testing. You'll see that's of the order of around about 10 megapascals after testing. The bottom right image, that's what happens to thermal spray aluminium coatings after 6 months. You'll see the scribe, there's no evidence of damage to the scribe. You'll see it's actually filled with white product. Those are calcareous minerals deposited onto the cathode, onto the exposed steel underneath. And those minerals actually are quite tenacious and provide something of a barrier between the seawater and the underlying steel. You'll notice the adhesion values are of the order of 20 megapascals. In fact, in this case, the coating entirely remains on the substrate. So this is a failure in the adhesive, not in the coating. So the bond strength is a minimum of around about 20 megapascals. So this is a very qualitative view of what happens in seawater and the difference between paint and TSA. We do have methods in which we can measure the rate at which the aluminium coating is consumed, from which we can determine the effective corrosion rate in microns per year of the aluminium coating. And I'll show you that in a moment, but just want to show you very, very quickly. Here's the electrochemical setup, experimental setup at TWI. We have a couple of these. One is we can do alternate or continuous immersion, depending on the environment. And we also have the ability to measure the corrosion rate at higher temperature as well to simulate things like hot oil pipelines. So this is some data from a JIP that TWI did for the oil and gas sector a number of years ago, which we had permission to publish. And from the electrochemical methods that I've just shown you, we're able to calculate the corrosion rate of aluminium coatings over time. Now, typically what we do is we have a specimen with a holiday in it, which you can see here. And over the duration of the test, you'll see again that you get this white deposit on the cathode, which is the little exposed area of steel in the center. The graph on the left shows you the corrosion rate in millimeters per year. So 005 is 5 microns. Per year, you'll see there are a number of lines there. Those are variants in the TSA in terms of composition. So some are aluminium, some are aluminium 5 magnesium, and some coatings are sealed with aluminium silicone and some aren't. But the interesting thing is that despite the variability in the coating specification, you will see that the corrosion rate of the coatings tend towards a common value somewhere below 5 microns per year, perhaps as low as 3 microns per year. If you're interested, this work has actually been published. It was meant to be presented at NACE this year, but that didn't go ahead, but the paper has now been published. So we know that TSA performs quite well in seawater. If you recall, we might spray it to the thickness of something like 300 microns. So a 3 micron per annum corrosion rate gives you confidence that you might have an effective coating for certainly more than 40 or 50 years. Just to mention that this is not the only project that we've done on this subject, and we've looked at the use of TSA on a wide range of alloys beyond carbon steel on stainless steels. And whilst most of our work in the initial days was for the offshore oil and gas sector, that work has tended towards more the renewable energy sector, including offshore wind, in the last 5 or 6 years. And just to show that the scope of our partners in these projects, again, you'll see the on the left-hand side, a lot of oil and gas companies that you'll recognize, and on the right-hand side, more focus on the offshore wind sector in more recent years. Interestingly, one or two companies, of course, are now transitioning their businesses, such as Saipem, perhaps from oil and gas sector into the offshore wind sector as the nature of the energy sector changes. So, if we look at the sort of historical or more conventional approach to the application of coatings on an offshore wind structure, what you'll see is that the immersed part generally has a significant amount of cathodic protection, and the splash zone is protected by a paint-based coating with zinc primer and epoxy buildup and a high visibility, bright yellow polyurethane top coat. But it's what's interesting is that for a while now, it has been quite common to use thermal spray for the tower above the transition section. So this is where there is no wave impact or no tidal impact. So it's purely in the atmospheric zone. So thermal spraying already is established in the offshore wind sector for this application. But what we're more concerned about is, based on what you've seen in the previous slides, is, you know, what can we do to translate the technology into, say, the splash and tidal zone or the immerse zone, where we know that aluminium is quite effective. So one of the most interesting recent developments is that TSA has been applied onto the monopiles for the Arkona wind farm. So this is an interesting situation because the driver here is the, in fact, is the low, relatively low salinity of the Baltic, which required rather more anodes than a conventional, say, North Sea located structure. And the design review of this indicated that perhaps there could be a significant saving in terms of constructing these monopiles if they went towards using thermal sprayed aluminium on the monopiles. So that that has happened. These have been installed, I think, for 3 or 4 years with this aluminium coating on the monopiles. There is very good video on YouTube, which I'm not going to run during this presentation, but the reference is there for you that shows this work being undertaken at Krebs in Germany. So in this video, you will see the grip blasting and the metal spraying of the monopile. These monopiles are sort of typical size, I think something like 65 meters in length and something like 7 meters in diameter. You can see where the spraying is happening. The gut there are, in this video, you'll see there are a couple of guns mounted on the end of the on the robot arm, and around that is an extraction system to remove the overspray, so it minimizes the dust in the environment. That's the purpose, and that's the purpose for that. So I'm going to come on to the Crown projects. These are a couple of UK based projects funded by Innovate UK, and these have run sequentially. There's Crown 1 and Crown 2, involving a number of partners, and you'll see who's involved in that in a moment. What I wanted to show you, because we haven't actually seen any metal spraying, is this video of the rolling of TSA coated plate. And the reason for doing this is the concept of being able to apply the coating to plate before rolling and fabrication. So it helps the fabricator to remove much of the coating application from the manufacturing sequence and saves a lot of time. So in this video, you'll see these plates have been coated with thermal spray aluminium, and they're going through the roller. And you can see there's some significant strain applied to the coating during the process. You might notice some marks on the coating surface. That's actually rust off the rollers and not damage to the coating itself. And this was part of this an interesting part of this project. Evaluation of these afterwards has shown that the adhesion is Sorry, I gather you can't see the video. So I apologize for that, and I'll just move on to the next slide. Sorry. Okay. So the Crown 2 project has carried on some of this work. It's a larger consortium, and I think also reflects some of the changes in the in the sector as well. And this work is now in progress, due to finish sometime next year. There's quite a lot. This is all involved in the de-risking the use of TSA for offshore wind. There are a number of aspects to this: corrosion, design, and manufacture. I'm not going to go through this in any detail because we don't really have time to do that. But what I wanted to mention was that one of the key outputs of this really is the generation of the guidelines and best practice for the incorporation of thermally sprayed aluminium into the corrosion protection design for offshore wind structures, primarily for monopiles. If you went to a jacket structure, it would apply to a jacket structure as well. So we're most of the way through that project. It's been running for a couple of years, and we're now coming towards the last year of the project, and all the sort of corrosion design and manufacturing aspects are coming together on that, with a view to producing this this document. In the meantime, nonetheless, have the capability at TWI, with the 20 years experience of working with industry on this technology, we have the ability to put together a TSA coating design specification, and we do this on a number of projects. So here's one here that we did a couple of years ago on for centralizers for a North Sea oil production development. But what we would do, depending on the specific application, is produce a document for the customer. And this is something that is designed for the supply chain. So in the 2018 project you see here, this example, we did this for the company doing the design, and they shared this document with their customer, who is the oil and gas producer, but also with the coating vendor who is going to undertake the work. So it's there as something that is a reference for the supply chain. And in this, we talk about the recommended coating system, the material, the best alloy for the application, and how to apply the coating, and what is required in terms of the coating vendor qualification, how to maintain the coating, and other aspects such as health and safety considerations, and useful technical references which support the rest of the documentation. So I think I'm coming to the end of my presentation. My contact details are there. I will stay around to answer questions at the end of the meeting. But otherwise, you'll have my contact details when you get the presentations from the meeting. Okay, so I think that's me done.
Excellent. Thank you, Dave. I think we might be able to share your video through Carol, possibly. I don't know, Carol, if you can share your screen and show the video that Dave was hoping to present. Perhaps while Carol does that, Dave, there's a few TSA questions that have come up. Perhaps we could answer a few of those.
Sure.
So let me find which one to start with. Okay. Do you think that coatings tests could be used to assess adhesives in harsh environments, both from a strength perspective and in terms of corrosion of metallic substrates in bonded joints?
Oh, that's a good question. I don't see why not. The testing is based on, we actually use adhesives to do the testing. And the systems we use, the tests we use have the ability to go up to really whatever the limit of the machine is. In practice, the adhesives that we use may have tensile strength. So anything, well, you saw in that, in the example, that the adhesive we used there had a strength of 20 megapascals. But, you know, for other thermal spray coatings, we use adhesives in an attempt to pull off coatings that go up to more than 70, maybe 90 megapascals. I hope that answers the question.
And so next question, Dave, there's a few here. For which areas can TSA be used? Splash, tidal, submerged, atmospheric, all of them?
Yeah, so TSA works best when you have a seawater environment. And by that, clearly immersion and splash and tidal are definitely covered by that. And it's because the aluminium coating encourages the reaction encourages the deposition of calcareous minerals into the to any exposed steel surface. When you get into the atmosphere, it's less reliable because you don't have the formation of those materials. And so in rainwater, it doesn't really give quite the same benefit. So that is why, for example, the towers are coated with zinc aluminium, because the chemistry of that reaction in rainwater is a bit different and is a little bit more suited. So you would use aluminium primarily, you know, in or very close to the sea.
Okay. Thank you, Dave. How important to TSA integrity is the training and skill of the operator?
That's important. In the same way it is for paint. So, you know, generally it's with any coating, a lot of the effort has to go into, of course, into the preparation of the substrate. And I didn't cover this in my presentation, but you have to meet very similar criteria in terms of surface roughness profile and surface cleanliness that are associated with paint. The standards are very similar. In fact, the metal spraying is based on paint. The specification is very similar. So that's the first aspect of that. Then the second one, of course, is the training of the operator as well. And the two processes we use, wire flame spraying and twin wire arc spraying, both lend themselves to manual operation, and indeed they can both be used for mechanized application. Like any process, if you can mechanize the process and remove the operator, there's a chance you'll get something that's a bit better.
And then a related question that I think you've kind of covered already. If the application quality is not controlled, is there a higher risk of degradation for TSA than normal coating?
Yeah, that's a good question. So, if you prepare the substrate poorly, then there is a possibility the coating will fall off. On the other hand, there's a lot of room for, I'm not going to call it error, but operational variability or application variability when it comes to spraying the coating. It doesn't really matter if the coating is a bit porous in a marine environment, because the coating acts sacrificially. So, you know, it doesn't matter whether there's, say, 2 or 3% porosity or 4 or 5% porosity, because the coating will still have the same effect, will have the same benefit to the underlying substrate. The key thing really is to make sure that the substrate, you know, that the surface to be coated has been prepared correctly and to prepare at the right time. I mentioned surface cleanliness, I mentioned surface profile, but in common with paint, you know, you have to, there are limits, there are humidity limits and temperature limits to applying metal spraying, and they're pretty much the same as they are for paint. You know, don't apply your coating when the humidity is higher than 80 or 85%. Don't apply the coating at a temperature below 10 degrees C.
And a follow-up question from the same individual. On coating thickness, is there a standard for offshore wind in place to indicate requirements for 25 or 35 year design lives?
Yeah, I mean, typically we would spray TSA to something like 300, 350 microns. It's not altogether critical. I think the coating thickness on the Arcona monopiles is 250 microns. That also has, on top of that, it has a thin layer of a red epoxy to finish off the structure. So that's typical. For the towers, which you saw, which have zinc aluminium coating, I think the standard spec for that is something like 75 to 100 microns of zinc aluminium, and then you have your epoxy build up and your polyurethane top coat.
Okay, and then perhaps one more question, and then we can save the rest until the Q&A session. Are seal coats typically used for offshore wind TSA?
Well, so that's a very good question. So the first thing is, are they necessary? Technically, no, because the coating will actually be sealed by its reaction with seawater. So one approach is, if it's not aesthetic or required for other reasons, is you don't need to seal it. However, it is common practice to apply a sealant or a top coat. One of the activities that we've been working on in Crown 2 is looking at the compatibility of a high visibility, say like a polyurethane top coat on the TSA, because that has given that. We know that we have one or two issues with the degradation of the top coat on or certain top coat materials on aluminium. So and that's one of the things we've been looking at in the project with some success. So that's one of the challenges.
Great. Okay. Thank you, Dave. You have lit up the Q&A board here, so if you can stick around for the Q&A session, that would be much
of appreciated. Course.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, everybody. Add,
the video that you you couldn't see earlier, we will send a link out when we send the recording of the presentation and the slides out to the attendees.
Okay.
Thank you, Dave.
Okay.
So our next presenter is Ujjwal Bharadwaj. So Ujjwal is a team manager at TWI. He's going to be talking about TWI's offshore wind integrity management services. So just while Ujjwal uploads his slides, I'll just introduce him. So Ujjwal works in our asset integrity management section at TWI. He's got a broad-ranging experience, including a master's from the London School of Economics and an engineering doctorate from Loughborough University. He's been with TWI since 2009, and currently he leads a team of experts developing bespoke decision support approaches and software to enable asset operators make optimum decisions based on a variety of criteria, particularly those leading to measurements of risk and life cycle sustainability. Over to you, Ujjwal. Thank you.
Can you see my screen, John?
Yes, we can. You're not in presentation mode, but we can see the slides.
Just a minute, sorry. Am I in presentation mode now?
No, we still see the slides with your...
I see. Sorry about this.
That's okay. We can't have an online webinar without one or two technical challenges as well.
Can you see my screen now?
Not at the moment. No.
Not at the moment. Okay, just a minute.
Perfect. Yeah. Over to you as well.
Okay. I can't see my screen. Just a minute, please. Ooh. Okay.
Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm okay, thank you. So, can you see my screen?
Yeah, we can see it.
Okay, yeah, sorry about this. So, good morning, thank you. I'm Ujjwal Bharadwaj. I work with a team of specialists within the AIM section of TWI. I want to show you today the range of activities we are involved in. So I've favored breadth at the expense of depth to fit this in my allocated slot. It will be evident from the slides that I present that we in AIM cover a broad spectrum of activities under the umbrella of asset management. So in terms of contents, I have a slide providing you with an overview of the functionality covered within the part of TWI I sit in. Then I have a presentation on a few projects showcasing the types of work that we get involved in. We've often worked with experts outside our team, both within TWI and beyond. Thus, much of what I'm going to present is a result of teamwork. There are four projects that I'm going to summarize in my slides. The first one is on the integrity management of onshore wind turbines. The second was a prototype software on structural reliability. It was a project finished a few years back. Then there's a software project on risk-based optimization of spares inventory applied to offshore wind farms. And then there is a software on decommissioning of offshore wind farms and life extension. Then I have a few slides on direction of future work. And if you're interested in these areas or have a problem that we can help you with, please do let us know. Hopefully we can help you. So in terms of the section overview, what we do in asset integrity management, we have a good track record of providing fitness for service and RBI services to industry. And we have a team skilled in quantitative analysis to develop tools to help operators manage their assets in a sustainable way. So we are in a good position to leverage our decades of experience, the so-called conventional asset management, fitness for service, RBI, systems engineering, with capability in digitalization and life cycle sustainability assessments. By digitalization, I mean applying advanced data analytics, could be machine learning on condition monitoring or structural health monitoring data, for example, and feeding this into a decision support framework in asset management using tools like MCDA or optimization, and integrating all this in an end user friendly software. Riskwise is a suite of software supporting operators to manage different types of assets, and a few examples are there, pipelines and boilers. The approach itself can be adapted to a variety of situations, and we're always looking for opportunities to develop this further by adding functionality or applying it innovatively. So we're increasingly involved in LCA and LCCA assessments, and sometimes combining these with risk assessments in a through life management approach covering risks, costs, and environmental impact. The first project that I'm outlining was on integrity management of onshore wind turbine blades. This was for a proposed wind farm in the vicinity of an industrial complex. Our remit was to develop a program of work for in-service risk assessment of the wind turbine blades. It was a staged approach that was adopted. The stages required active participation of the operator, the health and safety, the UK's health and safety executive, through road mapping exercises and regular reviews. The first stage was appraisal of candidate solutions, and this required quite a bit of iterations with stakeholders. There was an RB, risk-based management, risk-based life management roadmap meeting. There was a stage one deliverable, a report on integrity management of wind turbine blades. And there was finally the second stage, which was the selection and development of techniques and technologies. I will discuss the risk-based life management road mapping exercise a bit more. A number of TWI colleagues and representatives from the operator and HSC and other industry stakeholders were involved in this exercise. The discussion included a review of standards, state-of-the-art monitoring, manufacturing, design, testing, and quality control practices. A hybrid root cause analysis and FMEA exercise was undertaken to identify potential causes of blade loss, blade shedding. And it was something like this, for example. So this combines overspeed and manufacturing or installation defect leading to the blades being thrown off. The colors there indicate who would take these aspects further, so they don't have any significance for in terms of assessment. From stage two, so the discussion, the conclusions from the road mapping were that for an RBI approach to be developed for wind turbine blades, we needed a better understanding of damage mechanisms, what the factors that caused blades to fail, so that probability of failure, the consequences of such failure, inspection effectiveness, monitoring inputs from monitoring and historical inspection reports, the updating of probability of failure following in-service inspection. These were the crucial activities that were identified in the road mapping exercise. This led on to stage two, which was very useful to develop some initial steps towards a so-called, if you like, risk-wise for wind turbine blades. So that's the sort of a snapshot of the prototype that was developed. The tool drew on inputs received and developed a qualitative risk scoring methodology based on certain risk factors and efficacy of certain of inspection methods. I have emphasized the word initial steps there because the algorithms were developed and shared with the stakeholders, but unfortunately the project finished without a finished end product, as the operator decided to shelve the project for non-technical reasons. I mentioned this project because of two reasons mainly. It showcases one of the key strengths of TWI, which is the range of expertise available at TWI and the ability to combine such expertise with that from outside. So for example, in this project, inputs were obtained from HSE, OEMs, monitoring experts, composite material experts, and so on. The other aspect is also to that we are looking to build on such projects in light of new requirement and new technology. The next project that you see on the screen requires us to develop a risk-based approach to inspection of jacket structures with inputs from two different software packages, Bladed and Bentley Sachs. Bladed provided analysis from rotating machinery, and Bentley provided us analysis from the foundation and tower structure. And it was in TWI's remit to develop an interface and some sort of a decision support tool to help operators prioritize their inspection activities. The functionality developed was, as you would expect in a typical risk matrix, likelihood of damage calculated per year per member of the jacket structure. This was based on certain types of damage, fatigue damage, boat impact was considered because of the special requirements of, in this case. Then we considered extreme loading, parked operating, earthquake. We looked at consequence of failure overall. That was the overall loss of strength of the entire jacket structure as a system under extreme loading, given that some damage, there were certain members that were damaged. And these results were displayed on a risk matrix over a user-defined assessment period. So on the risk matrix, on the vertical side, on the vertical axis, we had the probability of a failure of jacket elements. And the horizontal axis, again, we had a probability, but in this case, it was the probability of the entire jacket as a system collapsing, given that certain members have failed. The sort of flow diagram that was used, it was modified as well later on, depending on the specific requirements, and that also evolved over time. But that's the gist of it. Analysis was done to identify which members to remove based on fatigue damage. And this was from a fatigue analysis and list members in the order of fatigue damage and start with the one that had the highest fatigue damage, remove that member, and then carry out further analysis to determine whether the structure fails or not. If not, then identify another member that has high enough probability of failing, and remove that member and sort of go through this loop and basically develop a risk profile of each structural member, which is then depicted in a risk matrix. The other project that I must mention here is project for developing a software for spares inventory management for offshore wind farms. So here the software supports operators to find the optimal trade-offs between the cost of stocking spares. And this cost included not just money, but space constraints, etc. And factors such as the risk of a stock out on the other side, which included production loss, penalties, and so on. There were different modes of optimization that was built into the tool. So one mode was to minimize risk within a given budget. The other mode was to minimize the total cost given a certain threshold of risk that is tolerable. And the third mode was a sort of a hybrid mode, which was on minimizing cost or risk given certain individual constraints like certain parts should not follow below certain quantity and things like that. There is more information available on this if you would like to read on this. The other project that I mentioned here is a project called Odin Wind, which was doing a remaining life assessment before a decommissioning decision is made, and actually helping operators to do the decommissioning. This was funded by the Danish national funding body called EUDP, and the project was led by a Danish organization called NIRAS. Now, decommissioning is often seen as the reverse of commissioning. However, it is more diverse and complex. The project developed software considering decommissioning as a whole with associated sub-processes. Data on sub-processes was collected and used to create a management software tool which would support operators in creating a decommissioning model. This is to forecast and outline the decommissioning of the wind farm at an early stage and actually optimize the actual decommissioning project to optimize the activities involved in decommissioning. This included, as I mentioned, an initial study on methods for estimating of remaining life so that what could be salvaged before decommissioning could be identified and things like that. So what was TWI's key contribution to this project? Contribution was on the report on the monitoring of wind turbines. This was co-authored with DTU. And the other contribution was to link up our CrackWise tool with the Odin Wind software tool. Now, CrackWise is a TWI software tool that automates fracture and fatigue assessment as per BS 7910. A case study was provided by the operator involved here, and that my colleagues worked on my colleagues from the fracture integrity management. And what you see on the slide is the results from that assessment. I won't go into the detail now, but yeah, if you have any questions, follow-on questions, we can take that. The other bit in the project that we worked on is on the development of KPIs for the decommissioning process. So the KPIs looked at project delivery, financial management, and health safety and environmental management. For each area, we determined key risks, performance factors, and KPIs. This was quite similar to the earlier project that I to the project that I presented earlier. This was through brainstorming sessions with a variety of stakeholders. So that's an example from the HSE area. Different formats for KPI performance and KPI performance and progress were developed within the tool. So there's a traffic light format showing meeting targets, activities that are meeting targets, that are close to meeting targets or not meeting targets. There were heat maps and that included scoring schemes, identifying activities and broken down into sub-activities with each having their own score of performance on the specific KPIs. There were progress graphs showing progress against target KPIs. Direction of future work. So apart from the improved approach to structural reliability and spares management that I mentioned earlier, we are looking to incorporate data analytics with risk assessments. So this is an example from a bridge project aimed at supporting risk-based inspections. So you, what you see on the screen is a decision support tool that identifies areas of damage within a bridge structure. It helps the operator to conduct risk assessments. There are two types of risk assessments: qualitative, quantitative. You typically, as you would expect in a risk assessment, you would have a probability of failure and a consequence of failure. Here, the probability of failure is updated in real time based on inputs from condition monitoring, structural health monitoring data. And what you have there is a risk matrix showing combining both the probability of failure and the consequence of failure of certain components within the system. On the top right side, you see two, there's some detail on the two types of, the two levels of risk assessment. So level one is when you use a more of a qualitative approach if you don't have much data to start with. And then you move on to level two, where which is more a data-based, a data-driven approach, as opposed to the previous qualitative one, which is which relies more on engineering judgment. The benefits from such an approach is these are the initial, you can actually, these are the initial steps towards implementation of a digital twin concept. And of course, a key element there is combining data analytics, artificial intelligence techniques with conventional integrity management approaches to improve the accuracy of assessment. There are a few other projects in similar directions. So on the bottom left-hand side, you have a machine learning tool developed within TWI for rail track inspection. So we have used machine learning techniques on historical data and developed risk profiles of different track segments and shown on a risk matrix. The middle case study there is on, again, that is from the wind energy sector, where machine learning tools have been used on data relating to proposed layout of wind farm, where there were some missing gaps in, there were some gaps in the data, and the gaps were, there was data available for certain depths in the seabed. However, there was missing data, and this missing data would require additional expenditure additional expenditure for the operator. And this is where machine learning tools helped us to give us some sort of a prediction on the soil condition of the layout in the layout area. The bottom right hand side is again, it's again a use of machine learning tools in ship maintenance. And here we are looking at here we are analyzing data from gearboxes and coming up with a system to flag up incipient failure so that remedial action can be undertaken by the asset operator. So we are hoping to build on this these projects and actually develop a decision support tool in the offshore wind sector, where we could combine data from different sources, including operating data, the weather data, and combine it to provide some real time fault detection or prediction capability to the operator. Obviously, helping the operator to increase or improve safety and the reliability of the asset. There is a green deal that I'm sure some of my colleagues may have mentioned. This is the green deal for proposals announced by the European Commission. What you see on the slide here is from our website, actually. We are working in this direction on a number of fronts. So if you feel TWI can support you in addressing any of your issues within the remit of this call, you're very welcome to contact us. So thank you very much. Through these projects, hopefully I've given you a flavor of what we do. I've been an active participant in all the projects that I've presented today. However, the projects have included clever and cleverer colleagues who have worked together as a team. So there may be questions you have that I cannot answer on my own. I shall answer those that I can and those that I can't. Please do contact me or my colleagues, and I'll make sure that the right person provides a response. So thank you very much, and thank you for this opportunity. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Ujjwal. Brilliant presentation to finish the presentations for day one. So if I can ask perhaps all the presenters to turn on their cameras and microphones. We will now have a bit of a kind of panel Q&A session. We have about 20 questions to go through. If there's any more that you think of or any follow-up questions that you think of as we answer these, then please feel free to put them into the Q&A box. Just before we do that, I'd just like to remind everyone that we have our second session will be tomorrow morning. So we split this over 2 days. So our second session starts at 9:10 tomorrow. And we have some presentations that complement very much what we've discussed today, talking about fabrication challenges, high productivity welding, composites, inspection, and then finally a presentation from the KTN on the funding landscape. So perhaps to start the Q&A session, there's some questions around the broad sector that we need to go back to. So the question here, probably best to Andrew or Chris to start with. Where did TWI see the market growing? With monopiles currently being the predominant method, will these be superseded or equaled by jacket construction? I.e., what direction should the UK industry plan for? The context is the ability to supply hollow tubular sections and have fabrication yards developed for jacket construction and investment for this to maximise UK content.
Hey, John, I can start off.
Okay. That please, Andrew.
That would be useful. I mean, so you kind of historically, I guess we've focused on use of monopiles, and as we've moved into deeper waters, we've looked to jackets to provide that solution. The goalposts keep shifting, and what's kind of happened is the monopiles are getting bigger and bigger and being able to get into deeper and deeper waters. So whereas before we thought the crossover was 30 meters, it's now 40 meters, potentially 50 meters. As monopiles scale up, and I'm sure Carol will have some thoughts on how big you can keep growing in terms of monopiles. At some point, then there's a jump to floating as well, but that depends on the cost reduction of floating, which will take time. But we think we'll ultimately get there. From a UK perspective, I think the other challenge is in terms of manufacturing costs. The cost of monopiles has come down. They're simpler structures, whereas jackets have proved to be more complex structures to manufacture. And from a UK perspective, where manual labor is more expensive than in other parts of the world, that's meant that has been a real challenge in terms of the fabricators who are manufacturing in the UK. So going forward, we're expecting still the growth of monopiles, but with some sites, so predominantly monopiles, but still some jackets, filling in some particular sites where seabed conditions don't particularly meet.
Thank you, Andrew. Maybe if I can direct a related question to Chris. So what is the major imported component of offshore wind turbines? And do you see an opportunity in market for investors to manufacture monopiles and more offshore towers in the UK?
Yes, I think, yes, certainly I agree with what Andrew said, that if you go back to 2009, that there was the trend was that monopiles would reach a maximum size and dimension and jackets would take over. But as it turned out, the complexity in building jackets restricted the amount of jackets built, and monopiles increased in number and size and geometry. The other issue is to do with installation. So the bigger monopiles get, the bigger the installation vessel needs to be. It's also worth mentioning that a jacket's got a pile at each corner. So there are four piles to a jacket as well, and they have tubulars. But I'd say that the serial production and standardization of structures is where the industry will go. So that if you're making a jacket, you use traditional UOE piping, it's an oil and gas type pipe to make the legs and braces out of, and more automation in fabrication. So making lots of similar structures means that automation and inspection of automated inspection and coatings take over as well. But in terms of the UK supply chain, I think there's a massive opportunity for all of these steel structures, whether it's suction buckets, whether it's jackets, whether it's piles. And even the transition pieces are getting more complicated. So they're not very, although they appear to be simple fabrications, monopiles are, but there is some ingenuity to be had in how you manufacture things. And that's what the UK is good at, is bringing about those automated, high quality, high performance products.
Thanks, Chris. And then perhaps a follow-up question to either Andrew or Chris here is, do you see the growth in offshore wind energy being able to take up the reduction in the oil and gas labour market going forward? So you've talked a little bit about the opportunity for the UK, and we've heard Boris Johnson talk about the number of jobs he'd like to create in offshore wind. Do you think this will help in the reduction in the oil and gas labour market over the next decade?
I mean, I think that there's a lot of focus on, you know, what's often termed the kind of just transition, and that move across, and how do we transition from oil and gas to renewables. I think at the top level, there's some fantastic opportunities, and you know, from a technology perspective, without a doubt, the experience from oil and gas is invaluable in reducing costs in offshore wind, and that will continue to happen both in a kind of structures, but also in a robotics and inspection and surveys and that side of things. The question about labour is as much about skills as it is about technology, and I guess that's where we need to look at kind of standardising of training for technicians, standardising of certification, and ensuring that those skills are transferable. When moving across, I think the other thing to remember is that a lot of the oil and gas skills aren't actually offshore based. They're based in offices, in the northeast of Scotland, northeast of England, Anglia. So how do we transfer those skills? And those are predominantly engineering skills. And it's how do we move those across as well? So I think it will happen. I'm not sure it's quite as easy as a kind of play really lift across. I think it's there'll be new companies which will develop and grow, and I think that experienced staff are always valuable when developing new companies. So I think it'll happen, but it'll take time, and it's not a straightforward a plug and play a move.
There's a question here, and I'm not sure the question is says, given there are currently no fabrication yards in the UK. Who could conduct jacket manufacture, who could undertake this. Chris, I'm not sure that's entirely correct. I don't know if you want to elaborate.
I don't think it's correct. Certainly Harland and Wolff, who are in the UK in Northern Ireland, did construct quite a number of jackets recently. I did think Bifab were a jacket fabricator, and certainly Smulders, who are, I know they're a Belgian company, but they have a base in the UK and have the ability to construct jackets. So it may be that they're not geared up for sort of massive serial production, but I suspect that with investment that could be arranged. So I think there are some jacket fabricators, and certainly they have the track record. Maybe they're not currently engaged in fabrication of jackets. I thought there were some examples. Certainly, Hull.
Yeah, I mean, I think, Chris, I mean, all the ones that are having difficulties of one kind or another. So it is a very challenging area, particularly because of competition from the Far East and Middle East.
Yeah.
I think what's worth watching going forward is Boris Johnson announced the £160 million fund for manufacturing sites. You know, I think that it might not necessarily focus on jackets. It's more likely to focus on towers and monopiles and that side of things, where I think with lower relative amounts of labour and higher opportunities for automation, I think that there's potentially more opportunities. So I think that that shift, that jacket to monopile shift, I think is something that we should be watching. And I think, you know, that the government's recognising that and is putting funding into a setting up, you know, potentially investing into setting up new facilities. So it's not an easy area. It's not an easy area to be successful in. But I think there are actually ways forward on monopiles and towers.
I think also it's driven by orders. That if there is a guarantee of a large order, then it's possible to tool up to do these things. I think historically what's happened is that the promise of a number of orders has made people tool up to make these structures, and then the orders haven't been fulfilled. So that's left some financial difficulties. So I think if there is a commitment to build, that the UK has the wherewithal to tool up to do it.
Great. Thank you, Andrew and Chris. We've got a few technical questions here to direct at some of the other panelists. So maybe start with one for Carol. So similar question to previous. Based on past experience in the support structures of offshore wind turbines, fatigue cracks initiate from corrosion pits or weld defects? Question mark.
Okay. Yeah. So, well, it just in general, fatigue cracks tend to initiate from stress concentrating features. So if you have a weld which is oriented perpendicular to the dominant applied loads, then then cracks are quite likely to initiate at the toe of that weld if the weld cap is present, for example. So whatever the most stress concentrating feature is in that structure is what's going to result in fatigue cracks to initiate. There is a question over this pit to crack transition, which is perhaps what the questioner is alluding to. And that is something that there's a lot of research going on at the moment, and TWI is actually doing some research looking at the transformation of real corrosion pits into fatigue cracks, again through fatigue testing and detailed analysis as well. So that is something that we are looking at.
Great, thank you, Carol. And then a few more questions for Dave on TSA. So a question here asking you to compare the main differences between flame spraying and arc spraying technology.
Yeah, John, I don't know how you want to do this, but I noticed there's actually several questions on TSA, and I just wondered if I just spent 2 minutes just trying to go through them.
Or yeah, if you want to try and go through them in the most logical order.
Yeah, no, I apologize. First of all, I'll apologize if I miss anybody's question out. It's not intentional, but there are quite a few. So there's a question about the use of TSA and cathodic protection in the form of anodes and ICCP. So basically, the rule here is that you try and make sure the coating is less negative than any cathodic protection system. We can adjust the potential of the coating by composition. It's quite a detailed question, so I'm not going to say any more than that, but just say, yeah, we can manage that. You have to be careful what you do, and please contact me for further discussions. There was a question about fouling and sea life and testing in real seawater. So there have been quite a few studies done of TSA in seawater. Notably, there's a very good one actually from the late 1980s by Sintef, which is well published by Gartland and Egan. We've also at TWI, we've been involved in some European collaborative projects where we've looked at the fouling of TSA in the context of offshore renewable structures. So we look, and it it was certainly the case, given the testing that we did, that TSA was certainly no more susceptible to fouling than paint, possibly less so. And actually, that is currently part of the current Crown 2 project. Flame spray against twin wire arc spraying. Technically, the adhesion of arc sprayed coating is superior to flame. Some people prefer flame spraying if they're manually applying it because there is less fume and dust, because the production rate is a bit lower. There's a question also about the price or the economics of TSA and paint, and the material side, aluminium wire, is a lot cheaper than paint, and you put down a much thinner coating. It then comes down to the cost of application. This is one of the reasons why we're looking at the mechanization of the process, the pre-application of the coating onto plate, so it takes it out of the production schedule, or most of it out of the production schedule for somebody fabricating a monopile. The other thing is, if you look at it from a whole life cycle cost benefit perspective, then the TSA lasts a lot longer than paint and requires less in intervention. There was a question about hydrogen embrittlement or hydrogen stress cracking, the use of aluminium. Yeah, definitely something that needs to be considered in the context of very high strength steels. We've done, that was actually in the list of projects. We did some work on duplex stainless steels probably about 15 years ago. Again, there are ways and means of managing that by using a coating with less that is less electronegative. Again, come back to me for further discussion of that. And there was I'm not sure I've covered everything, but there was one final thing I'm going to comment on, is the TSA buried below the mudline. Yeah, there's always this concern that we don't really seem to understand the microbiology below the mudline, whether there's a coating there or not. People are concerned about it, but there's no evidence that anything has failed that I'm aware of as a result of microbial behavior of TSA coatings below the mudline for offshore wind structures. I think I have to stop there and let somebody else have a go.
Yeah, thank you, Dave.
There were a lot of questions.
There's a few more TSA can have you been speaking, so maybe I'll ask a couple of panelists, a couple of different panelists, other questions while you go and review the new questions that have come through.
Okay.
So I think, Andrew, one for yourself, this question came up quite early. It says, could you elaborate a bit more on the assumptions made for floating cost in 2030? So I think the cost of floating foundations. And then a comment saying it maybe seems a little optimistic.
Yes, I mean it's there's work that our analyst team did, and they looked at the different components, and they looked at the cost reduction trajectories. A lot of the cost reduction comes from volume. It comes from doing it at a large scale. So moving from a kind of 30 megawatt a wind farm to the 80 megawatt Tampan one, then kind of 100 megawatts, and then scaling up 200 megawatts and beyond. And in doing that, each part of the supply chain will learn how to do things better, and costs, I have no doubt, will come down. The rate that they come down is the trick. What we've seen is how the costs have come down for fixed bottom, and we expect similar trajectories for floating. One of the things that's worth remembering is that we're quite unusual in the UK to have so much shallow water around us. If you look at the rest of the world, most countries don't have 30 meter, 40 meter water depths around them in the volume that we do. So actually floating wind is going to be hugely important around Japan, around the US, South America. I mean, there's areas where they just don't have the option. And I think that some of those areas where they are actively pursuing floating will actually drive the costs down probably before they get back to the UK. And from a supply chain UK perspective, what we're keen to see is that the UK maintains its lead rather than those technologies going abroad being developed abroad and then the lead being taken up there. And the Prime Minister has committed to 1 gigawatt of floating wind in the UK by 2030. That was another of the commitments that he made. So largely by volume, we have a floating wind centre of excellence. I'll put a link in the chat to that, and anyone that's interested can follow up with that, because that's where the analysis come from.
Great, thank you, Andrew. We have a question here, which is, what is the best inspection technique for blades? We won't answer that. I'll use that as an opportunity to highlight that we're talking about inspection tomorrow. So come to the webinar tomorrow, and you should hopefully get the answer for that. If not, you can ask one of our NDT experts attending tomorrow. I think there's also a couple of queries about access to the webinar for tomorrow and what is the right link. So we will confirm that via email shortly. There might be a little bit of confusion there. A broader question about the offshore wind sector. Are there any current certification programs available for the offshore wind field?
So is that from a technical basis, I guess Carol was talking about some of the standards. If it's talking about certification in terms of skills, there are certification programs for skills. I don't have them off the top of my head, but I'm happy if the questioner gets in touch, I'll find out and provide some links on the training side.
And yeah, from a technical point of view, if they mean kind of design standards, then I mentioned the kind of generic fatigue design standards in my presentation, but some of the DMV documents, there are several DMV documents specific to wind, and one relating to wind turbine structures, and the design of those structures is DMV ST0126, I think, from memory. It's got a lot of information in there.
Yeah, and similarly for the fabrication codes, DMV GL have a series of codes, including OSC401, and from a design point of view, it's OSC101, I think. If you go on the DMV GL website, we'll give you a good pointer to the design and fabrication codes.
There's one J101 or something, 101 or something.
Yeah, C101 is a design code.
Thank you all. Dave, are you prepared for another TSA set of questions?
Let's go for it. Okay. Again, apologies if I misunderstand the question, but I'll have a go. Just to come back to the question of the use of TSA with cathodic protection, just to mention that on the Arcona system, where they just have TSA, there is no additional CP. Certainly not at the moment. They have designed the structure so that CP can be added in the event that the coating fails, but that is not the plan. But I do recognize that with existing facilities, if you install something with TSA coating, you do have to be careful. And we have done some modeling of this, trying to get to grips with this in the Crown project. So again, come back to me. If you want to take that discussion forward. There was a question on the subject of PLETs, which I take to be pipelined end termination. So I don't think it's specifically necessarily an offshore wind question. I think this is a submerged pipe question. And what we're talking about here is the abutment between TSA coating and some other form of coating or insulation. So the rule here is that we don't really want to apply, well, at that abutment, you would generally avoid any overlap between the two. So they have to abut, or in some work we've done where we've looked at corrosion under insulation, it was acceptable to leave a very thin line of exposed steel between the two coatings, because the aluminium coating will actually protect that exposed steel, and then that avoids any issues such as the as you get between at the overlap between paint and TSA. There was also a question about the difference between aluminium or zinc aluminium and sealing. So the first thing is in seawater or the splash and tidal zone, the corrosion rate of zinc-based coatings, either zinc or zinc aluminium, is about 3 times the rate of aluminium. So you have to factor that in. You either have to put down, if you're going to go down that route, you have to put down a thicker coating or accept that it may have a slightly lower design rate. Zinc, aluminium and zinc are very effective, but they're in a way they're too effective and get consumed more rapidly. We certainly know that we have fewer problems with sealing zinc-based coatings. There was a question about mechanical damage from boats coming up to the up to the monopiles. So a couple of things here. One is that the impact properties of TSA are significantly better than paint, and we've done some work on this again in another project. So the impact resistance is better. But the other thing is that if you do get some scratches or damage to the TSA coating, then it is sacrificial and will protect any of the steel that is exposed. And I think there's a question also about the base material. What can you apply TSA onto? So basically, carbon steels and a whole range of stainless steels are not unusual. And really, it's just down to good surface preparation, which you can do on all these materials. I think I've covered most things now, John.
Yeah, there's one more question, and then there might be a couple of other TSA ones that have popped up as follow-up. So if you want to have a quick look while I ask this final question.
Okay, yep.
And then we can come back to you and finish up by 12:15. Chris, one for you. I think the answer is no, but you might be able to elaborate a bit more who else is operating this area. It's RTWI developing technologies for preventing fires from starting inside the nacelle of wind turbines, such as braking systems?
Not that I'm aware of from TWI's perspective. Perhaps Andrew might have some knowledge of developments in that area.
I'm not aware, but if someone's got some good ideas they want to share and see how we can help to commercialize those or use them, I'm happy to have that conversation. I mean, there are fire prevention systems, but I'd need to see the details of what people are looking at.
Thank you both. So Dave, are there any final comments from the TSA questions that you need to mop up here?
Okay, I'm not sure. I think this might be a TSA question from Tobias Ruby. How about the relation to corrosion? What is your experience with corrosion modeling and testing? So we're doing TSA modeling on the Crown 2 project. So that's part of the project to look at what to look at how it works on a structure like a monopile. So that is something that we have ongoing at the moment. Again, contact me about that and I can put you in contact with the specialist. I think we've covered there's a question about the practicality and effectiveness for onshore wind for TSA. So yes, I think that would be good, particularly if you're in a coastal location. The specification would probably be zinc aluminium, much like you have on the towers at the moment. And there are lots of onshore structures protected in such a way. So that would not be unusual. I think I covered the one about mechanical damage. I've talked about CP. I've talked about the difference between aluminium and zinc aluminium. I think there was one about aesthetics and the fact that you get the corrosion product of aluminium is white. Well, the corrosion product of steel is red. I'm not quite sure what the the point is that I guess you're protecting the underlying steel structure, of course, from corroding, and eventually, you know, that could lead to loss of structural integrity. So I'm guessing that I would argue that that is better than seeing conventional red rust. How's that?
Yeah, excellent, Dave. I think you've picked up all of them, and
I hope so.
Thank you for the participants for asking the questions. If there's anything that we haven't covered, or if there's any follow-up questions, and I believe all of the presenters have shared their contact details, so please feel free to email them or contact them directly. So I'd just like to take this opportunity now to bring this webinar to a close. So thank you again to all the presenters. I think it's been a very interesting morning, and I'm looking forward to the second session tomorrow. I'll just share the agenda for the second session so that people can see it. So we will be starting at 10 past nine. I've heard a few people haven't got the link, so we'll be resending that to those that haven't received it. So keep an eye on your emails and enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you again, and hopefully we'll see you again tomorrow morning. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you. Goodbye.